I would like to introduce you to Dr. Gregorio Mora-Torres, who received his Ph.D. in Latin American history from the University of California at Irvine. He teaches in the Department of Mexican American Studies at San Jose State University and has published articles on Northern Mexico, U.S.-Mexican borderlands, and Chicano history. He's presently researching the history of Mexicans in Northern California during the 19th and 20th centuries. And I'm thrilled that he has agreed to give our lunchtime lecture today. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Mora-Torres.
This is a presentation I'll be watching today. It's going to be based on a lot of articles that I took out of the San Jose Mercury News and also a Mexican bimonthly magazine, El Excéntrico. And so I want to show you this images that have been a part of San Jose for a very, very long time. Enjoy this presentation. I actually initially titled it Preserving Mexican Culture in San Jose. As you can see, changed it to Living Mexican Culture in San Jose, 1940 to 1970. Okay. One of the things you need to know about Mexicans in San Jose is that they're not immigrants. A lot of them are immigrants, but the history of San Jose, the Mexican history of San Jose dates back to 1777. There's really people from that are coming from northern Mexico, Sonora, Sinaloa, that are coming to settle San Jose. And ever since then, there has been a Mexican presence here. The people that came to San Jose are kind of an interesting mix. Usually we think that they're basically, if they're not Spanish, they're mestizo. And mestizos are individuals who are basically part Spanish and part indigenous people. But in fact, you're going to find that, that a lot of people coming from Mexico have all kinds of different racial mixtures. Some of them, as you can see by the names, there are some people that are called mulattos, and they're African. Who are also who have made it with Spaniards, and they have lobos, Africans who are also who have made it with indigenous people, coyotes. So a lot of these names are kind of interesting. In many ways, the demeaning, but these are actually the legal titles that were given to people when they were born. Okay, and so they first came in 1777, and the official name of the town of San Jose was San Jose de Guadalupe. Okay. And it was founded here across from this museum. Okay. As you can see, this is the earliest map of San Jose. And if you get a chance, the way you know this is San Jose is because the blue line that you see is really the Guadalupe River. Okay? And the official town would basically, the northern part of the town would be the area a little bit north of Santa Clara Street, okay? And it would be crossed by this irrigation ditch and a acequia. And so you can see that the majority of the people that were living here are actually farmers and they need to farm. Then you wanted to find the little plots of land. And that land that you see is what we now call Market Street. This is the old road that came from Monterey. And it basically went down through downtown San Jose, and you can see it goes up into Mission San Jose. Okay. In the 1880s, you have obviously the population of San Jose now being mostly Anglo-Americans, and there are a few surviving Californians. And at that time, a lot of the Anglo-Americans began to think about trying to reconnect with the early founders, but they got this mistaken impression that the people who settled in San Jose must have been the Spanish colonists coming from Spain. They came across Mexico and settled in San Jose. And in fact, it's kind of a myth that often was promoted by the Californians themselves. Beginning in the 1700s, you begin to see people coming from Sonora, Sinaloa, and some of them are even from central Mexico. Okay? Nevertheless, this idea of the Spanish presence in northern Mexico, California, existed all the way to the 1960s, and that myth is you can see is reproduced by news by cultural events. For instance, in San Juan Bautista, you have this celebration of Spanish Days in San Juan Bautista. Here you have, supposedly, yeah, the Spaniards came to California and they have a Spanish trail, and the people are actually trying to imitate the early Spaniards. Here you have a police officer supposedly dressed as a Mexican with a hat. Obviously, it's more like a flamenco hat. And then some people are trying to relive life. And so at the Fox Theater that's now open again, they were staging a play called La Española. Again, the idea that it is Spaniards who are living in California, not Mexicans. Okay? In the 1920s, before we go that, then we have, again, people trying to recreate this idea of those kind of dances. In fact, they're actually Mexican dances. Okay? In the 1920s, there was this event that was celebrated to try to get the people to come and shop downtown. So they decided to create a parade that was called Día de las Rosas, or Fiesta de las Rosas. And this Fiesta de las Rosas continued from 1920 to about 1931, 1932, when it ended because of the Depression. Well, in the 1970s, people thought it would be a good way to attract people back into San Jose by bringing back the Fiesta de las Rosas. Again, trying to give this idea that California was a Spanish, was an area that had a heavy Spanish presence. And this was an event that was basically criticized by the Mexican population, especially by the Chicano movement of the 1970s. And eventually this parade ended up in the police arresting a lot of Chicano militants. And that was the end of this attempt to bring back Fiesta de las Rosas. Okay. And so they even had a queen, and the only queen that this woman had, so they have a Melody Raines being elected as the only Fiesta de las Rosas queen for the 1970s. In fact, like I said earlier, Mexicans have lived here in San José since 1777. They never went away. In fact, the Mexicans remain in the old Pueblo San José, which is basically Santa Clara Street, Marcus Street, San Carlos Street, and obviously the Guadalupe River. Okay. I want you to see this is a map of San José in the 1940s, and this is where the old Mexican Pueblo was, and by the 1940s it began to expand away from downtown. But still, the limits are basically Santa Clara Street. It expanded all the way to Montgomery Street. Market Street remains the east side of the barrio, and then it has expanded south into Virginia Street. And throughout this time, Mexicans continue to celebrate Mexican culture, and there are several areas that they like to visit. A lot of the restaurants and bars are located between Santa Clara Street and Market Street. They would go to either Holy Family Church, which is the blue dot over there at the end, or sometimes they would come to St. Joseph's Church, which is on the corner of San Fernando and Market Street. Oftentimes, they would pick the Civic Auditorium as a major place for organizing cultural events. But then they also have a dance halls, and this one right here, which is across from the camera theaters today, or was across from the camera theaters today, this is the Rainbow Ballroom, and there was another one called the Starlight Ballroom, which is right behind the ANSA Hotel. Okay? And so these are the areas where Mexicans tend to congregate a lot throughout this 1940s, 1960s. One of the things that we need to realize is that Mexicans are very devoutly Catholic. And so one way of keeping the culture alive is basically by celebrating the major religious holidays that Mexicans tended to celebrate. And obviously you're going to see Easter is a major event. Día de los Muertos, which is Day of the Dead, which is celebrated November the 1st and November the 2nd. Día de la Virgen de Guadalupe is the day when the Virgin of Guadalupe appeared to the Native American Juan Diego. That's December 12th, and then Christmas. Okay, and so you can see that Mexicans are going to celebrate them in San José. This is obviously Easter, preparing for Easter. This is a picture of the celebration taking place at Guadalupe Church on the east side. Okay. Easter again. And sometimes they would even reenact the crucifixion of Jesus Christ at Holy Family right along the Guadalupe River. This is the celebration of the Virgen de Guadalupe, December the 12th. You can see people actually dressing up to honor this Virgin, which is obviously the patron saint of Mexico. And so they reenact her apparition. You have mariachis playing. And this is 1969. Again, Mexican, you see a Mexican flag. This is downtown San Jose, by the way. And the person who used to be kind of a beloved priest is actually an individual by the name of José Peña. He was the major priest for the Mexican American community, the Mexicano community. He used to serve at the Holy Family Church. He's actually a Spaniard. José Peña was born in Spain, okay? And he served at the Holy Family Church for about 20 years until he died in 1968. An extremely beloved priest, incredibly Mexican. He was single kinds of ranchera music, or songs, especially for the Mexican Revolution. Another way to maintain culture is basically the Spanish language station. And there's all kinds of radio stations serving in Santa Clara County. They began to broadcast as early as in the late 1940s. You're going to find that practically the entire Mexican colonia downtown, but there's also another colonia in the east side, are listening to music as early as 5:30 in the morning. Keep in mind that a lot of these Mexican Americans are working in agriculture, a lot of them are construction workers, they tend to get up early. And so radio helps them wake up. You know, they're having breakfast at 5:30 and they're with loud Mexican music. And you can see that they listen to quite a few interesting people. Lalo Caballero, who was one of the early disc jockeys, that's a locutor. José Alvarado, I don't know if you know who he is, but he was the husband of a very prominent Mexican-American politician. Does anybody know who she is?
Blanca
Alvarado, okay. That's how Blanca Alvarado met José Alvarado. There was also a very distinguished disc jockey by the name of Carlos Graham, Eduardo Guichpatoni, and then this other individual, Jesús Reyes Valenzuela, is also a personality among the colonias in San Jose. Okay. And so here you have José Reyes Valenzuela, and he was on radio from about 1940 all the way to about 1975. And obviously you can see the programs that he has, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning, it's a very important hour for him, so he sells a lot of space, a lot of ads, and he's back again at around 4:30, 5 o'clock in the evening. But you can see this is music that they're playing. And they play basically from about 6 o'clock to about 10 o'clock at night. And the person is Lalo Caballero, the one who's holding the sign, okay, that's Lalo Caballero. Okay. And again, he's also, he's serving as a disc jockey from 1948 all the way to about 1980. Okay. And all of these people are well known. Oops. And this is a picture of Blanca Alvarado in the 1960s and her husband, José Alvarado. He's probably one of the most influential Mexican disc jockeys. He basically sees himself as a representative, a spokesperson for the Mexican American community and the Mexican community throughout the 1950s. By the 1960s, there is a major movement of Mexicans coming from Texas. And usually they like to call themselves Tejanos. And so they're bringing their own music. So by 1960s, you have this individual, Daniel Alonso, you know, even catering his own program. He has a program called the Tejas de California, where they play all Tex-Mex or Tejana music. And he's also, you know, very popular in San Jose. Even Father Jose Peña has his own radio program. Obviously, religion is a very powerful way of, radio is a very powerful way of disseminating religion. And so he's there. Mexicans love dancing. And you're going to find that as early as the 1940s, they're using the San Jose Civic Auditorium, again, not too far from here, as a major venue for dances. Then they go to the Rainbow. It's another another place where they go dancing. Again, the Rainbow used to be right across from the Paramount Theaters, and then the Palomar. Later on, it was called the Starlight Bowl. Okay. And so they love to listen to all kinds of music, and it's not necessarily Mexican. They often bring groups from the Caribbean region, mostly from Puerto Rico, Cuba, okay, but also from Mexico. And they usually go to the San Jose Civic Auditorium, the Rainbow, the Starlight. Okay, and the type of music that they used to dance to is the cha-cha-cha, the rumba, the mambo, danzón, cumbias, merengues, and then all kinds of regional Mexican dances. And so you can see some of the regional Mexican dances. Here you have this ad where this Hermanas Ph.D are gonna be performing in the Civic Auditorium. Yes, imagine, you know, 2,000 to 3,000 people going to this dance. And because the tickets are rather inexpensive, sometimes the whole family will go there. It will take, you know, grandma, grandpa, you know, your little brothers, even the little babies is sleeping there while they see the young ladies dance with the boyfriends. Sometimes when you have political representatives coming to speak to people in California, they always have music. And again, this is the Civic Auditorium. Okay. You have this Mexican trios. The most popular ones are Los Panchos, and this is kind of romantic music that the Mexicans love to hear. So you see Los Panchos come in 1953. The greatest of all Mexican charros, Pedro Infante, who comes to the Civic Auditorium October 25th, and 1953, 3 years before he dies. And so you can see this immensely popular Mexican artist coming to San Jose. And keep in mind that there aren't that many Mexicans in San Jose at this point of time. This famous female singer, Maria Luisa Landin, she's a frequent visitor to San Jose. Okay? And the promoter is this individual, Frank Davila. Again, he stays over and over again, quite a few times. Luis Alcaraz, Mexican. Danzón, and so he brings an entire orchestra to play, and then Pedro Vargas, and then this other woman here, Maria Victoria, perhaps the most popular female singer at that time. Okay, Pérez Prado, he's Cuban, who settles in Mexico after the Cuban Revolution, 1960s. He's a frequent visitor to San Jose. Okay. And Lalo Guerrero is one of the first Mexican-American singers. He's out of Arizona, but he's began to sing, coming to San Jose to sing basically what we call Mexican-American music. Pedro Bugarin is also from the Caribbean Islands and you know, most likely Cuba. And so he's coming here, 1958. Okay. This is after 1958. I guess Davila believes that the Civic Auditorium is becoming too expensive, so he moved over to the Rainbow Ballroom. Again, it's across from the Camera Theater, so he's bringing Osvaldo Sandoval, Los Marcianos, Gilberto Valenzuela and Carlos Campos. These are all orchestras. Okay. And then by the 1960s, Dávila has now moved his base of operations to the Starlight Bowl. He's began to recruit local musicians. Kiko Morales, Frank Camacho are all local musicians. Okay. And then for the first time, you're going to get to see Little Joe in his Latin years. One of the best and most popular Tejano groups in the 1960s and 70s. So he's beginning to make his way to San Jose. And one of the reasons why is because ever since the 1920s, 1930s, they have had this huge migration of people coming from Texas. And by this time, they have settled down in San Jose. And so he's appealing to this Tejanos that are now living in San Jose. Andy Flores is also a local musician with his group. And now we move over to perhaps what is the essence of being Mexican, celebrating Mexico's national holidays. Okay, so that's how they're going to celebrate it. Okay. Again, after the United States took over, Mexicans stayed pretty much in their old Mexican town. Eventually, the town, the barrio, the colonia that was established there was surrounded by Italian immigrants. So they basically go around and eventually the Italian community expressed all the way down to Willow Street and beyond Montgomery Street. So they basically took over much of the area for Mexicans to expand. So eventually they had to, Mexicans, if they wanted to find new homes, they had to go to the east side. Okay. Nevertheless, in spite of the fact that the Mexican barrio remains pretty much limited, Mexicans continue to celebrate Mexico's national holidays in the downtown area. Okay. And so they essentially celebrate two national holidays. You have the first one is Cinco de Mayo, and you're going to find that Cinco de Mayo is a major event, okay, even for Mexicans here. And what they're celebrating is really the defeat of the French in 1862 at the Battle of Puebla, Mexico. And there's a lot of support for Californians towards Mexicans who are fighting the French. And so that memory still lives among Mexicans in San Jose as late as the 1960s. And then the big event is the 16th of September, which is really Mexico's Day of Independence. It is the event in which Mexico breaks away from Spain and becomes a free and independent nation. This is really what Mexicans celebrate. Okay. And again, there are two routes that they take. Every national holiday begins with a parade. And this is perhaps the most Americanized of the events. It involves bringing in all kinds of school bands, local merchants who want to advertise to the Mexican community. They all participate in this parade. Okay, and obviously there are some events that show Mexican culture. So they usually go by taking, the major parade route is basically on Market Street. They start Santa Clara and then move south, and then they make a left, right on San Carlos. And basically it's the major events are held in around the Civic Auditorium, okay? And so here are the parade routes. They can make that left. There's another one where they go First Street and then make a ride on San Carlos. Okay. Oops. Okay. This is an invitation for the 6th of September event, 1894. So Mexicans have been celebrating this event since the 1890s. And if you notice the names over here on this screen right here, you're going to find the names of Alviso, Castro, and Berriesa. These are the original families that came to San Jose in 1777. And they're still celebrating Cinco de Mayo. Okay? 6th of September, sorry. In the 1940s, you have Mexico celebrating let's say September. And usually, you know, there are about 2,000 people attending this event, this parade. They even have parties at night, and then again, 1950s, you can see that there's about 5,000 people going to the celebration of Mexican independence. And this is 1960s, where you have the parades. Again, they're coming down First Street, making a right on San Carlos. And obviously, you have the high school marching bands there, which are part of the events. Look at that float. The American flag is part of the celebration. Okay, this is right across from the Pacific Auditorium, before the light rail was there. Again, high school participants. There's the traditional Mexican hat dance. And everybody dresses in Mexican costume, the charros, the china poblana. In every event, in every contest to elect for Cinco de Mayo, and it's a big event for young women. Just imagine being declared the Queen of Cinco de Mayo, the Queen of 6th of September, before the entire community. You know, that's a very popular thing to do. And here you have you know, contestants of 1950s. Again, candidates for Queen, 1955. This is the 6th of September Queen for 1966, and Alexandria is going to put her in the front cover. She really looks majestic. And this is another one from 1970s. Besides the parade, they have this incredible program. See, this is what's missing nowadays. Today, you know, when you talk Cinco de Mayo, 6th of September, really, you know, beer parties. This is really a cultural part, and where they have a cultural program, a cultural literary program. So they start with music, then they have they recite poetry, then they remind people what the 6th of September or Cinco de Mayo were about. Okay. And so they invite people to go inside the Civic Auditorium. So you have about, you know, 5 to 10,000 people, actually about 5,000 people there, you know, for 3 or 4 hours, just going through this entire program. And so you have a lot of regional dances that go on towards the end. And then afterwards they have the coronation of the queen, and the event's pretty much over probably around 5 o'clock in the evening, okay? So you have the parade in the morning, and then the cultural event starting at 2:30. And you see this for both Cinco de Mayo and 6th of September. 10,000 celebrants, 1974. Let me tell you that after 1970, this parades and this events become incredibly huge. By the 1990s, there's about 80,000 people attending this big parades, and sometimes they reach 100,000, and it's huge event. Okay, for both Cinco de Mayo and the 6th of September. And this is Cinco de Mayo. Again, Mexicans celebrate Cinco de Mayo. This is at the Almaden Mines. Okay, circa 1890. Again, you see similar attendance. 5,000 people go to the Cinco de Mayo parades. This is 1954. 1970s. You know, it's the family event. They bring kids, old people, to this event. Here's obviously a person dressed like an old man from Michoacán, La Danza de los Viejitos, the dance of the old man. And then it's a kid who happens to kiss the queen, Cinco de Mayo, and a
friend, he doesn't like it very much. Please send the prime.
Okay. The other event that draws a lot of people to San Jose, to downtown San Jose, is films. And Mexicans have been going to see films in San Jose ever since the late 1940s. There was a theater almost right across from St. Joseph's Church that used to be called the Teatro Liberty. Okay. And so you have Mexicans basically from the barrio walking down to see movies, and they show films every day, by the way. On weekends, you have people coming from the surrounding communities, Santa Clara, Milpitas, Aliso, even Gilroy. And you also have a lot of farm workers. There, in the 1950s, there are thousands and thousands of braceros working in Santa Clara Valley. So they also come downtown. And they usually come to see, they usually come to the movies. After the movies, they basically go have a Mexican meal and then have a few beers before they go back home. The films are important because it helps Mexican immigrants remember their past. It connects them to their homeland, to the culture, to the music, and to the culture of Mexico. But most important, it also helps the US-born children of these people to become familiarized with Mexico, because they see Mexico through those images in the films, but also with the culture. Okay? And so this is what US-born Mexican-Americans are going to be watching. And keep in mind, they're also perfecting their language, the Spanish language. This is 1950, cuando los padres se quedan solos. Okay. Ustedes los ricos, you the rich. Okay, obviously, this is a film that criticizes the rich in Mexico. This is 1960s, you can see, and they also, in this film, you're gonna be able to see perhaps Mexico's leading stars, leading actors and leading actresses. La Bandida, the Bandit, okay? And obviously this is a film that deals with the Mexican countryside, cockfights and things like that. This is Live in Jalisco, Ay Chabela, the title of a famous Mexican song. And so this young kids are learning about Mexican culture and learning the language. El Dorado de Villa, okay, one of Villa's soldiers. Okay. And then you have Yo Pecador, which is a story about a priest, or he's having doubts about being a priest. And Pedro Armendáriz is one of the great Mexican actors, and Libertad Lamar, again, a leading Latina actress, I think she's from Argentina. They even have this little kid, Joselito. This is a kid that had a magical voice, 1960s, he's a Spaniard. And so you have a lot of Spanish films coming to San Jose. And so you Mexicans are watching this also. Obviously, you know, Maldición de mi raza, okay, the curse of my race deals with the issue of race. A lot of people don't believe that there are black people living in Mexico. In fact, you know, there are some areas, Veracruz, Morelos, who has large populations of blacks. And so they have to deal with this issue of race. And obviously Mexicans are dealing with that. El Rey del Tomate is a story with Piporro, one of the most interesting actors, kind of a comic. Okay. It's a story of a Mexican that comes to work in the United States to pick tomatoes and goes back to Mexico, filthy rich, and begins a new life. And you wonder why they come. Okay. And then obviously, perhaps the best known of all Mexican actors, Cantinflas, that earned a worldwide reputation. He's very popular in the 1960s. 1970s. Okay. El Padrecito, which still comes out on TV today. Again, another movie about Las Tapatías. A lot of people in San Jose come from the state of Jalisco, so this is something that would appeal to them. And then the other one, Conspiración de Kini, obviously this is a modernist type of film, James Bond type. The other thing that attracts Mexicans downtown is boxing. And I want you to realize that in San Jose, because we have no professional sports, boxing is the biggest attraction for both, for people of all ethnic groups. And boxing is the only place where you have people actually congregating without regard to race. And so they come to obviously support their favorite fighters. Okay? And obviously they go at the Civic Auditorium. And so the biggest star for Mexican Americans is this guy, Henry Paz, 1940. And he continued boxing. He probably would have been able to take a shot at the national championship. Okay. They have another guy right here, Peralta. Leonard Serna. Okay. These are all local fighters. Okay. And the Civic Auditorium usually attracts a big crowd. You know, their fights are usually on weekdays. Tuesdays are for boxing. You can have as many as 2,000 people there. Okay. And so George Serna is a good local fighter. Perhaps the best of all the local fighters is individual Eddie Chavez, who starts fighting in the late 1940s, reaches his best boxing early 1950s, 1952, 1953. And everybody thinks he's gonna become a national champion. In fact, you have one of the major networks coming to televise one of his big fights. Unfortunately for him, in 1953 he gets drafted and he goes to serve in Korea, and after he comes back his career is pretty much over. And so you have this guy, Juan Padilla. This is one of the big fights that Eddie Chavez fights, and a lot of people in the crowd believe that Juan Padilla actually won the fight, but the local referees gave it to Eddie Chavez, and so this, it almost turned out to be near riot. And so you have Eddie Chavez there again. And this is a big fight, 1955, where he gets knocked out, and it's pretty much over for him. Another great boxer who's also a local, Luis Molina. He actually lives in the barrio, over there by San Carlos and also raised in that area. And so he grew up fighting here, and again, he's being considered a potential fighter. Okay. Wrestling, lucha libre, is also a big event. So you can see this guy, Vincent Lopez, fighting in San Jose, I give the Civic term, as early as the 1940s. Okay. Enrique Torres, okay, 1950s, very popular character. But the biggest idol for Mexicans in the 1960s is this guy, Pepe Gomez. And he used to have a nemesis by the name of Quinche Chibuya. He used to throw salt whenever he was fighting Pepe Gomez. And so he's a good guy. Quinche Chibuya is the bad guy. And throughout the 1960s, is the one that entertained the people in the Mexican American community. So you have Pepe Gomez, and Luis Martinez fighting. The nemesis, Kenji Chibuya, and Mitsu Arakawa. Okay. One of the other things that is important in terms of preserving culture is the fact that there is this news, this weekly or bi-monthly magazine, Excentrico, that invites people to have any writing ability, or at least the will to write, to send in columns and letters to the editor. And so, so you have people writing poetry, writing short stories, and an accepting of publishes them.
Okay.
Some of them actually become quite famous. This is one of the individuals, he never wrote for the Atlantic, he just happens to be the first local to actually write a major novel in Mexican Chicano literature. José Antonio Villarreal, in his novel Pocho, deals with the life of Mexican Americans growing up in Santa Clara County in the 1940s. And he talks about alienation, he talks about preserving Mexican culture. And 1970s, this book is picked up by a lot of Chicano literature classes as an example of Chicano writing. So he was very famous. Eventually he wrote other novels. Okay. One of the local writers is this guy, Sierra, Dave Sierra, who used to write a lot for the Excéntrico. And he also wrote a novel, you can see it right there. And so he's got talent. Perhaps the best known of all contributors to an extent and go is, who is he? Mm-hmm. About this, okay. You can tell that this guy is an actor, he's already prepared to be in Hollywood. And he's an interesting individual. He writes this column called El Machete. And this column, he wrote about five or six columns throughout 1964. And this is a column that he wrote after he comes back from Cuba in 1963. And he's very nostalgic about the Cuban Revolution. He believes that the Cuban Revolution is actually good for people. Okay? And all of a sudden he gets all this criticisms from the conservatives in the Mexican American community, including Justo Sierra, who see him as basically a communist. Yeah. But he doesn't mind. He likes taking the criticisms. And so he's going out there to write. And obviously, eventually, he becomes a famous playwright. Okay, he's a local. He was writing this column while he was in San Jose State. Okay. And another local, he's initially from Oxnard. This is Francisco Jimenez, who works and teaches at Santa Clara University, has written all kinds of short stories and obviously novels about his life mostly. Okay. Very well known. Okay. And the last local person is this young lady, Lauren Di Cervantes, considered perhaps one of the best Chicano poets even today. Local, and she is actually born in the barrio, and she writes a lot about her poetry, deals with how the Mexican barrio San Jose was destroyed by the construction of 280 in the 1960s, and she was obviously dislocated, and for her this impression is deeply expressing her writing. Okay, and so I hope that you have gotten an image of culture, life in San Jose. I want you to realize that Mexicans have been here since 1777, and they're here today. They haven't been removed so much from the local downtown area. Thank you. Any questions?
In one of the first slides about beauty pageants, it said, the girls who sell the most votes won. Mm-hmm. So, was it a charity and a self award? What did that mean?
This is, keep in mind that it takes a lot of money to raise funds to organize the Cinco de Mayo events or the Cinco de Mayo events. The one way of raising money is to have the young candidates basically sell tickets, $1 a piece. And so the person that won the most tickets or that sold the most tickets will be declared the winner.
Costume wrestlers in the
have,
was that style of wrestling
done
in San Jose as well?
Yeah, in fact they would, keep in mind a lot of this wrestlers are copying Mexican wrestling.
Right.
In the 1950s, 1960s, so the mask wear are very common here.
Were their favorite mass wrestlers here?
No, because the one that the most popular of all those wrestlers was Pepper Gomez. And he was a clean cut individual. Wanted people should know who he was, so he wanted to show his face. There was another guy by the name of Cicuro Negro who wore a mask. And that's because he was evil. The Black Cyclone, or the Black Hurricane. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
You were talking about one of those DJs, Carlos Graham, back in the early 50s. His son, Robert Graham, became a famous sculptor, married Angelica Houston.
Mm-hmm.
The guy that did the statues of the headless torsos at the L.A. Coliseum for the Olympics.
Yeah.
He actually went to San Jose High School.
And he's also the one that wrote the sculpture of Quetzalcoatl.
Yes.
Right across from, the Pacific Auditorium. So you can see that. Those historical roots reappearing again and again.
Luis Valdez actually was a student over at James Lake High School.
And San Jose State.
As well as
yep.
San Jose State.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed Ernesto de Larson is not included, and I'm wondering if that's something that you've had difficulty.
It's not that that I didn't include him, it's just the fact that I see him more of as a political person, a labor organizer. Obviously, he wanted to give a presentation about political activism and labor activism. You have to include Cesar Chavez and Ernesto de Larson, who are also locals, and fortunately cover here.
I'm noticing it's kind of missing an element of lowrider culture.
Yeah, the lowrider culture is post 1960, 1970s, and I was trying to cut it short, so that's the reason why I decided to limit it from 1940 all the way to 1960. But there is a lot of, at one time San Jose was the capital of low riding in San Jose until the city began to. Yeah?
Lowrider magazine.
Lowrider magazine was started here, eventually went to Salinas, but it's part of the culture. Mexicanos that come from Mexico, but even then, they divide between people who come from Jalisco, Sonora, Sinaloa, okay. And so people who come from Texas call themselves Tejanos, and so that's the reason why they and they come, but they bring in a different type of culture, a different type of music. The term Chicano is mostly a political term; it's an ideological term. It's the recognition that they're proud of their Mexican culture, their Mexican ancestry, but they also believe in being active politically to redress you know, past discrimination, racism, and they're basically pushing for social justice and political inclusion. And so it's a more political term. The reason why I emphasize this, that's the reason why I went to come speak here, because most people today think that Sal Cinquedas was the original Mexican colonia. Okay. And Sal Cinquedas is located in the area around Alum Rock, perhaps where 280 becomes 680. And it's the area around where Guadalupe Church is located. At that time, this was a very small colonia. The majority of Mexicans lived downtown. When Mexicans simply couldn't find any more space because they were surrounded by big-time communities, they began to move to the east side. But that didn't happen until the 1940s. And what the point that I wanted to show here is basically that Mexicans have been living downtown ever since 1977, but they never went away. And that's the reason why they continue organizing the cultural events downtown.
I always thought that Sal Cinquedas referred specifically to the east side, and I grew up there, and I knew that that's what we were called as living in Sal Cinquedas. I was in Salinas taking a deposition, and this guy had this large wall map that was made by the Southern Pacific Railroad in about 1870. And it had lots of places and lots of place names, and Sal Cinquedas shows up on them. Turns out it just refers to a swampy land where it's difficult to get out of if you get caught in if you're there. So it turns out that it's more than just the east side, but rather any place where you have a swampy land.
It's an area where there's a lot of clay. So when you're walking, your shoes get stuck to the mud. And so that's the reason, get out if you can. And so yes, you know, so Sal Cinquedas was originally actually founded by Puerto Rican migrants who are coming to San Jose to work in the fields. Eventually it becomes more Mexican.
I was gonna mention right now that you're on this topic of Sal Cinquedas and East San Jose. As you know, we listened to the lecture by Stephen Pitty. You know, I think one of the best political histories of San Jose that very much fits your presentation is Stephen Pitty's book, The Devil in Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. And he says what you said about Sal Cinquedas, you know, around the Guadalupe Church area, it was all canneries. Mm-hmm. The canneries put out a lot of water. So the people who worked there would, you know, had trouble getting their cars out a lot of times because there weren't sidewalks and roads.
Yep.
And so the Sal Cinquedas had to do with trying to get out your cars out of the work area.
Yeah, this is during the rainy season, you know, when the water doesn't go anywhere. So you get stuck in the mud and the water. So it's very difficult to get out of Sal Cinquedas.